returned to South Africa this year as the Chief Financial Officer of Xstrata Alloys. Having spent most of his career in the UK, he joined Xstrata London in 2004 as a manager in the strategy and M&A team, where he played a key role in the evaluation, due diligence, and execution of various transactions. In 2006 and 2007, Hanre was the project manager for Xstrata's integration of its 20 billion Falcon Bridge acquisition. He subsequently headed the Investor Relations Department, overseeing the Defense Against Violet approach, $5.5 billion capital raising in 2009, the acquisition of the 25% Lonmin stake, and the merger of Equals approach to Anglo-American. Hanre holds a Bachelor of Engineering from Stellenbosch, as well as an Honours Bachelor of Commerce and an MBA from Oxford, and he is here tonight to address us on the subject of the proposed carbon emissions tax and the implications for the ferrochrome market.
Thank you, Laura. Good evening, everyone. John's seemingly sold you all on the DC arc furnace, but I'll do a little bit of promotion on the premise just afterwards, just to keep the competition going. I've decided to broaden the topic slightly to include the electricity price impact as well. I think rather than just carbon tax, kind of that is sort of a knock-on impact, or has a knock-on impact through your electricity price line. I think, as John has also shown, electricity price is a key component of our cost base, and certainly in terms of strategy of the ferrochrome business going forward. In terms of the agenda for this evening, I'd like to just start off with the South African context. I think it's important to understand the background of the mining industry, the industrial impact that carbon and electricity pricing has in the South African context to frame this debate, and really go through the key issues and gripes we have with the carbon and energy debate that's going on. And lastly, I think it'd be remiss to not say something about how the ferrochrome industry and the South African ferrochrome industry has responded to the debate, and how we think they will continue to respond. In terms of South Africa's geological prospects, I think it's interesting to note that South Africa is actually probably the richest country in the world when it comes to mineral wealth. A good friend of mine, Craig Sainsbury from Citigroup, did a report about 2-3 years ago, and he estimated that South Africa has $2,500 billion of mineral wealth in the ground. Problem is, it's in the ground, and you've got to get it out. And we'll get to that. But looking at the global rankings, of course, we by far the biggest we have by far the biggest PGM reserves: manganese, chromium, gold, aluminium, and we can go through those. So it's clear that South Africa's just got a rich endowment, and the question then is kind of how do we actually use it? And the sad story is actually that over the last decade, South Africa's mining industry has actually declined, and this has been during the biggest mining boom in history ever. And you would see countries like China, Chile, Russia, where the mining industry has thrived over the last decade, and there's been a dramatic contribution to not only GDP growth, but employment that the mining industry has brought. A country like Australia is perhaps worth pointing out, that Australia, through the resilience of the mining industry, was able to be robust through what the Australians call the GFC, the global financial crisis. Sadly, South Africa, during that same period, the industry shrunk by 1% in terms of contribution to GDP. So kind of very sad actually, kind of that with that rich endowment, we weren't able to perform better over the last decade. And I think it's quite evident as well, if you look at the rest of South Africa, that this is not a South African issue, but it's a South African mining issue, where a lot of the other industries has grown quite in line with the rest of the world. So on the x-axis, you've got the performance of the rest of the world over the same time period in terms of growth in industries and a contribution to GDP. On the y-axis, you've got South African contribution for the same industries. And it's quite evident that mining is an outlier in the sense where kind of there's been a dramatic increase in the global contribution that mining gave to the GDP of the rest of the world, but not in South Africa. Just to underpin also still the importance of the mining industry, I really told you a bit of a sad story about mining of the last decade, but I think it's important to note that mining today still is quite an important sector, not only in terms of job creation and jobs, but also contribution to the fiscus. And I think this also talks to the nationalisation debate, where there's this perception that mining in South Africa is done by foreign companies that extract dividends and take that overseas. But if you look at the pie graph, and I should have actually added the percentages there, but you can work it out, 25 billion of a total contribution of 364 billion is paid out in dividends to companies. The rest is pretty much put back into the country in terms of taxation, labor costs, repairs, purchasing locally, investment. So I think it's quite important that there's a recognition of the role that mining plays in the country. I think that talks not only to electricity pricing, but also the nationalization debate, as I mentioned. Coming now to carbon emissions, I think in terms of, and this is always the stat that's put out, in terms of energy intensity, South Africa is a reasonably high emitter of carbon. On the y-axis there, you've got per capita emission of carbon. And in that sense, South Africa is pretty much in line with developing countries such as the UK, Germany, Spain, South Korea, and Japan. The issue, though, that some people have with South Africa's emissions, that if you look at it on a GDP basis, we're actually pretty high, nearly a 1.6 tons per GDP unit. And I think you've got to recognise, though, that this is not the only picture to look at when it comes to the carbon tax, debate. The emissions that you have per GDP unit, of course, is due to a number of factors. I think quite critically in the sense for South Africa, it's due to the industrialization phase where we are at the moment. So you would see that the more developed countries typically have GDP emission or per capita emissions when you measure it by GDP on a much lower scale than industrializing companies or countries like China and Russia, Indonesia, for example, Ukraine, move out to the right, and typically you would move to the left as you go through development into more advanced industries. The real picture to look at, though, and I think a quite important perspective, moving on from the intensity perspective, is the absolute terms that emissions are emitted. And I think there it's critical to note that China has now surpassed the USA as biggest emitter of carbon globally. And I think also interesting to note that of the top six countries in the world, they're accountable for more than 60% of global emissions. Moving down the rankings, and I've got the top 20 carbon emitters globally here, South Africa is there on the 18th position gives a mere 1.1% of total global emissions. What I'm not trying to say is that we're small, we shouldn't do anything. I think we've got to recognize that everyone's got to do their part when it comes to global warming. But I think it's important to put into perspective the potential that can be a change that can be brought about by individual countries. For example, to put it in perspective, if we as South Africa, if we adhere to the commitments we gave in Copenhagen, and we'll get to that, which I think was quite extreme, our savings over the next savings to 2020 will be emitted by China within 3 days. So quite a dramatic difference there in scale that I think is quite important to note when it comes to this debate. So moving on to the actual carbon energy debate in South Africa, I think the biggest frustration we've had, and I think Xstrata has played a very active role in lobbying the government, lobbying various government agencies in this debate, is that there's a massive policy incoherence. I think what this tries to illustrate is that there's various national strategies that the national government's trying to pursue. For example, departments would pursue kind of wellness, skills development. Department of Education would have specific strategies. Water security, the kind of Department of Energy, for example, energy security. Department of Environment, looking after environment, and they all in the end need to focus on these kind of overarching objectives. And I think there's recognition by government that coherence has been lacking when it comes to policy making. And unfortunately, I think the National Planning Commission has been to date toothless in coordinating the various departments. And I think the risk that we are seeing at the moment playing out is that the Department of Environment doesn't speak to the other departments when it comes to coordinating, meeting these overarching objectives of economic growth for the country, job creation, and ensuring that there's an equitable share in the spoils of this. Second issue, really, when it comes to the debate, and that's really, for me, quite a critical issue, is that there's a proliferation of doomsday prophecies, unsubstantiated claims about kind of various solutions about the problem. And I think kind of the key is just that we should go back to basics and understanding what the carbon problem is really about. And I've just put up here a simple slide which just cuts back to the basics. Where does the carbon come from? And I think quite critically, and I think people forget that, is that power generation is only responsible for 40% of the total carbon output, and there seems to be an unwieldy focus on power. I think we've got to look at the total carbon footprint globally to understand this problem. I don't want to get into the debate of whether carbon really causes global warming. We'll park that aside. But I think when it comes to carbon, it can be very, very well measured and understood where exactly the carbon comes from. There's a significant component from the transport industry, so from motor vehicles, air transport accounts for nearly 25% of the total carbon output. Industry is also a significant emitter of carbon, and within that, steel accounts for about 40%. And then buildings and other is also a significant component, and within other, there's various various smaller kind of issues, and kind of one of those that a friend of mine always points out is the methane emitted by cows, of course, and kind of methane has a significantly higher impact on greenhouse gas than carbon dioxide. So I think it's important that within the context of the debate, there's an appreciation of the full extent to carbon emission. In terms of then the gripe about the environmental tail wagging the dog, so the environmental agencies perhaps over-promising kind of on behalf of the rest of the country, I think Copenhagen was a great example of that. If I just look at the South African commitment, and you can scan down, South Africa committed to with a base year of 2020 reduce their carbon emissions by 34%, which is actually the second highest of that group there. So kind of compare that to a country, an industrializing country like Russia. Russia picked 25% as a high abatement scenario, 15% lower abatement. They've kind of very cleverly picked 1990, which was effectively their highest level of carbon output. So gave themselves a pretty soft target. Countries like China and India also copped out. You would see the little asterisks, which indicates that the 45 and the 25% respectively for China and India doesn't relate to an absolute reduction, but more an intensity reduction, so per unit of GDP. And if you convert that and factor that into an actual absolute emissions impact, we'll see that China's commitment in Copenhagen was that their emissions would rise by 496%, and India's offer would be a 350% increase in carbon from their 1990 levels. So pretty easy targets, I would claim. Let's get to Brazil, a 38.9% reduction, which seems at face value higher than South Africa, so good on them. I think the reality, though, is that Brazil's got a significant advantage over South Africa for the fact they've got massive rainforests. They are getting credits for not cutting down trees. So kind of that, to me, that doesn't quite bode the same as the commitments that South Africa gave. I think the one And perhaps that's lucky, and it doesn't say we shouldn't commit to these targets and work towards reducing carbon. But luckily, the easy out for South Africa is that the 34% came with a contingency that rests on foreign aid, and that there's conditionality around that. I think the important thing that when we get to carbon abatement in South Africa comes back to the fact, and that's where I started about the establishment of a cohesive and a correct fact base about carbon emissions. What I've shown here is the Australian abatement curve. Australia did a lot of work on carbon emissions, and effectively what they did, very similar to a cost curve, they took the total inventory of available carbon that could be reduced and plotted it on the, so that's on the x-axis. On the y-axis, they plotted the cost or the return of actually reducing the carbon. So for example, on the left-hand side, you see improvements in energy efficiencies, which actually, if you do that, you would save money. And obviously, those would be the kind of the obvious ways of reducing carbon. And you can easily plot that, and you can do the study to plot that across the whole spectrum of power, industry, transport, buildings, all the various carbon emitters. And critically, I think interestingly, you'll see that power actually gets you to the top end of the cost curve. So if you want to reduce carbon emitted from power, it's actually quite a costly exercise where you could focus on much lower cost and actually revenue-generating ways of reducing carbon. I think just in terms of South Africa, we've seen the white paper published by the government. I think we've moved a lot from where the original green paper was a strategy or an immediate action plan for carbon abatement to where the latest white paper recognises that this fact base needs to be established. So I think there is certainly hope that the government's working in the right direction, establishing the right fact base. But what is worrying is that we've recently seen that the National Treasury is pushing forward a approval through Parliament to implement carbon taxes by 2013, 2014. And from our side, we certainly caution against that, where you've got to establish the fact base first, understand where is the best ways of abating carbon, and then push that forward. In terms of then kind of the issue and the problem with carbon, and really why not only from a pure economic sense it doesn't make sense to tax the power industry and indirectly the power intensive industries, is also that we've seen through Eskom quite a significant tax, if you may call it that, on the country and of course the energy intensive industries. What is interesting actually, and quite ironic if you look at the IRP price path which is plotted there, so historical numbers are up to 2011, of course. The blue line continuing is the IRP forecast of Eskom's pricing, so quite evident, of course, the dramatic increase in power pricing. And not only is Eskom trying to recover the cost of capital of new expansion through sort of kind of pre-funding by getting the revenue in, is actually also an environmental levy built into the current electricity price, already a form of a carbon tax, a renewables levy of $180 rand a tonne of carbon. The environmental levy is 25 rand a tonne of carbon. So originally we've got a 200 rand a tonne carbon tax built into the current electricity price. And of course, then you've got subsidies for the poor built in there. So a significant tax already put through to the electricity consumers by the government, and I think that's quite important to recognise this when talking about the carbon tax debate. So enough gloom and doom, but perhaps just to bring it home closer to us in the room, and I think that's really where we've seen this dramatic change in the industry, where South Africa used to be, alongside Kazakhstan, the cheapest producer of ferrochrome in the world. We've seen over the last three, four years South Africa becoming less competitive, and I think that's probably experienced by everyone here. But the reality is that over the next 3-4 years, and that again is projections, that's still up for debate. But if we've got the 33%, 24% increases in power price, it would certainly blow South African smelting out the water. You've got to ask what happens in China and the rest of the world. Of course, kind of John made the point of reductant pricing going up. Electricity prices will also go up quite dramatically globally. But for sure, in South Africa, we'll see a dramatic increase in power. I'm not going to leave it there with just the bad news. I think there's been some good news, and I think perhaps just to underpin the impact that electricity price increase could have on the ferrochrome production, we'll see that effectively if you exclude a carbon tax, if no carbon tax is introduced, we'll effectively see kind of the marginal producer in South Africa will stop making a profit in 2016. So we've plotted the cost there of a typical South African ferrochrome producer. The green bars are the carbon tax for those struggling to read font size 8 or whatever that was. And I think if you see that between 2016 and 2017, we project that the industry will really start to struggle. If you add carbon tax, of course, we'll see that much sooner, that in 2014, 2015, the smelting industry in South Africa would be seriously threatened. And effectively then, we'll have more than 50% of the cost base on ferrochrome production on carbon and electricity. At the moment, it's around 20-25%, as John's numbers also shown. So, kind of really, I think that's a serious threat to the industry. Just in terms of how that has already impacted the industry locally, I've spoken about the mineral endowment of South Africa, of course, on PGMs and chromium. We're around 70-80-90% of the world's reserves and resources. But the market share of South African chrome producers declined quite dramatically. We were well over 50% in 2001, and will certainly now drop to below 40%. And this has really been driven by kind of the demands placed on smelting, proliferation of ore, including UG2. I think Tim will give us more of a perspective on that. And that's really seen China grow from around 5% to a market share of over 30% when it comes to ferrochrome production. And that's already having significant impact on the local producers. Again, kind of the frustration is that I think ferrochrome, and I spoke about mining's contribution to national GDP, South Africa's ferrochrome industry also is a significant employer. We employ about 200,000 people directly and indirectly, and it contributes $42 billion to the fiscus. So quite a sizable contributor to both jobs and GDP. And the risk, of course, is that kind of where ferrochrome exports kind of create much more jobs than purely ore, you could see a dramatic drop in terms of jobs if South Africa becomes purely a chrome producer. And the same, of course, on the GDP contribution, as you would export lower value chrome ore rather than the ferrochrome production. I think luckily the South African industry has established itself as an industry leader, and I think we'll continue to advance in technological ways to counter these sorts of cost pressures. I think also we'll see the rest of the world catch up in terms of cost pressures. So certainly in terms of furnace type and design, South Africa is leading the way where we employ mostly closed furnaces. Of course, that's also a response to environmental demands. In terms of furnace size, that also drives efficiencies. On average, we've got much bigger furnaces than the rest of the world. And critically also, and John alluded to that, on power consumption, if you look at the average, it's around 3.68, which is significantly higher than the other competitors. And I think also underlines this flawed view that sort of exporting carbon and smelting to China will solve the carbon issue. Actually, China, of course, is less efficient in smelting chrome, so we'll produce more carbon for the same amount of ferrochrome output. Now, to the promotional side, I think Xstrata Alloys has also done significant work in making sure that the South African industry remains resilient and robust. We've invested over 8 billion rand over the last 5 years in technology to improve efficiencies. You'll see our energy efficiency over the last decade. The initiatives include the Line 1 and Line 2 smelters. We're busy building Line 2 at the moment. and also the Bokomoso and Svelopele sintering plants, which we've installed. I think importantly, we're also looking at IPP solutions to produce our own own power. Our brothers at Xstrata Coal is willing to sell us some of their discard coal at an exorbitant price, but yet we'll buy it and generate some electricity to ensure that smelting in South Africa will remain alive and kicking. And of course, also I think a partnership with Eskom is quite important, where we've worked closely with Eskom in terms of demand management, in terms of interruptibility of supply. And I think perhaps just in closing, it's perhaps worthwhile noting that there's a sort of fallacy that South Africa would be better off without smelting. And I think the reality is that smelting, whether it's through aluminium or chrome smelting, gives an important baseload component to power usage in South Africa. And you can speak to any technical person at Eskom, and I think there's a recognition that baseload power demand is quite important for Eskom. We actually subsidize a lot of their other residential use, and actually kind of there's this flawed view that the rest of the industry is actually subsidizing the smelting industry. The converse is actually true. And of course, also we give Eskom the key to be able to manage their demand, where kind of there's significant shutdowns in winter. Of course, it's sort of enforced by higher tariffs, but Eskom is able to manage their demand. So I think that the smelting industry is quite critical, not only in terms of jobs, employment, but also in terms of the future of power generation in South Africa. That's it from our side. Thank you very much. I think if I look at nickel pricing, copper pricing, coal pricing.
Since we are one of the biggest producers, shouldn't we be commanding the price of our commodities and not having to sort of neglect all of that, since the chrome and ferrochrome are key components from the steel industry? So we are exporting everything at almost discounted rates.
Yep.
If it carries on in this decline, well, the increases we've got will be quicker than
what you're buying. Absolutely. I think the hope for us is that there's some sort of sanity in terms of electricity pricing, of carbon tax. I think that those are key components. I think also, we've experienced that firsthand in talking to the other countries' producers, that we will see electricity pricing going up quite dramatically in the rest of the world. China, for example, I think is going through a sort of a turning point where kind of they're moving away from a low cost producer to a high cost producer. So hopefully the pain we've gone through now, the efficiency that we've driven, will help us going forward. I think another critical component would be ore. I think we certainly see ore supply becoming less or call more tight going forward. There's suddenly an abundance of UG2 coming through, recognition that you can export ore and you can make good money from that. But those sorts of easy tons of ore would also decline, and we hope that a more balanced market would prevail, and that the South African industry will remain strong. I'll start with the difficult question first. What's the outlook for the next year and a half, 2 years? I'm busy with my budget that we'll present to PLC next week, around about the same time. I think the question is very difficult to answer. I think, unfortunately, we see the stainless steel kind of environment still much more exposed to the developing or developed world kind of Europe, the US pretty badly hit. And I think kind of questions still on what happens to the euro. Will it fall apart on a daily basis? Kind of, it's either great, Europe is going to stick together, or Europe's going to fall over. And that happens, kind of, we can spin and yo-yo between those sort of views on a daily basis. So it's very difficult to say what's going to happen in the short term. I think it's going to be more factors outside of our control. I think in terms of the longer-term outlook for stainless steel, as a company, we certainly see that as a late-cycle commodity, so where the intensity of use in China is still very low, and certainly we expect that to be higher than even the developed countries when it matures, as stainless steel is actually quite a new material, so kind of construction actually now prefers stainless steel, where previously, for example, industrialization of Japan or US, it wasn't available. So there's potential for steel intensity to be higher in China, and we see that as a significant growth opportunity for the stainless steel industry, so projecting around 5-6% per annum demand growth in stainless steel, and of course ferrochrome would follow. So we certainly still see this as a key commodity within the broader portfolio. In terms of competitiveness, I think unfortunately kind of South Africa has gone through a pretty bad patch. Kind of we spoke about electricity pricing, spoke about chrome ore. I think the rand has also been a significant factor, where I'd argue we've had a rand that's been unsustainably too strong, especially if you compare it to the Kazakhs, for example. So we've been through a tough patch. I think the sort of move of ore exports to China would we see that as kind of our view is that would moderate kind of the availability of ore. A lot of ore was released by sort of incentive pricing that made it worthwhile. But we see that balancing out as well. These sort of currencies play impact. Kind of relative cost of electricity, that also plays an impact. But we see, and there's certainly hope that sanity would prevail, and we'd see Eskom pricing moderating, whilst the rest of the world, kind of where there's certainly kind of looks to be quite a lot of pressure on energy globally, that energy prices would increase there as well. So we believe there is still a bit of hope. We stop it there. Thank you very much.